I am Mohan Gurjar from the specialty of critical care medicine. Today's talk is therapeutic hypothermia after cardiac arrest. The concept and use of therapeutic hypothermia after cardiac arrest to improve neurological outcome has gained popularity over last few years. This is a usual case scenario we come across during the in the emergency room, in the ICU, or even in the primary health setup. A 54-year-old man was found unconscious at home by neighbors who brought him to the emergency room. At arrival, patient was not breathing and had no pulse. Advanced cardiac life support measures done, including chest compression and epinephrine injection, along with endotracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation. After 15 minutes, there was return of spontaneous circulation. Now, GCS is still 3. So, now what to do? We know we come across as a primary physicians many times receiving the patient who had recently cardiac arrest. After doing the basic life support or advanced cardiac life support, usually if we fortunate enough, there is a return of spontaneous circulation. Later on, we admitted them in the ICU for further care. Either patient survived or later on they died. So exactly what happened these patients we receive after the cardiac arrest? So natural course of these patients who survived after the cardiac arrest, these two studies highlight this case scenario. Like, first one is the Jorgensen et al. From the Denmark. They had published their natural course of the patient who had recently cardiac arrest. This study case series published in the Resuscitation in 1998. They studied 231 patients, and they had found out that only 17% patients were able to survive to discharge with good neurological outcome. So it is less than 1/5 of the patient who were successfully resuscitated after the cardiac arrest. While second studied by Lever et al. In 2004 from the UK, published in Intensive Care Medicine 2004, they also followed 205 patients after the cardiac arrest, and they had found out that survived to discharge from the hospital only 40%, while survived to discharge with good neurological outcome was 20%. So now we know it's too large follow-up after the cardiac arrest. Only less than 1/5 of the patients they had survived at the time of hospital discharge with good neurological outcome. So we can conclude that anoxic brain injury and neurological dysfunctions are major source of morbidity and mortality after recovery of spontaneous circulation. Or in another word, we can say perhaps the most important manifestations of the post-cardiac arrest syndrome are neurologic. Therapeutic hypothermia, in another term, targeted temperature management is a therapeutic intervention that is intended to limit neurological injury after a patient's resuscitation from cardiac arrest. Just few pathophysiology about the brain injury. How these things happen after the cardiac arrest? We know once the circulation is stopped, oxygen store depleted within a few seconds. While there is a depletion of glucose and ATP store, it takes hardly few minutes, within a 5 minutes. So ultimately, there is a loss of transmembrane electrochemical gradient, as well as there is a sequential failure of synaptic transmission, axonal conduction, and axon potential firing. That lead to the intracellular calcium accumulation and later on release of glutamate. The final result is the brain cell death with bad neurological outcome. Another kind of injury we had seen in this case scenario, after the cardiac arrest, once we revive these patients, there is a chance of reperfusion injury, that called the secondary brain injury. It happened due to the formation of reactive oxygen species, as well as there is a lipid peroxidation, endothelial activation, leukocyte infiltration, and further tissue injury. Other possible contributory factor after revival from the cardiac arrest that lead to the poor neurological outcomes are hypotension, hypoxemia, impaired cerebrovascular autoregulation, as well as presence of the brain edema. So, what hypothermia do to limit these neurological injury? So, important mechanisms are that hypothermia prevents neurological injury by reducing the cerebral metabolism. We know that each degree centigrade reduction of the temperature that lead to ultimately 6 to 8% reduction in the cerebral metabolism. By that, there is a decrease in oxygen utilization as well as decrease in the ATP consumption. By other possible mechanism by which hypothermia prevents neurological injury are, it inhibits release of glutamate and dopamine, it induces brain-derived neurotrophic factors, it attenuates oxidative stress. Hypothermia also reduces lipid peroxidation, and as well as it inhibits apoptosis. This decreases apoptosis by induction of anti-apoptotic BCL2, and there is also suppression of pro-apoptotic factor BAX. Also, hypothermia causes suppression of the inflammation. What are the clinical evidences of the hypothermia to use after the cardiac arrest? In fact, there is a description of therapeutic hypothermia in modern clinical medicine is available for last 200 years. In 1803, Russian method of resuscitation, they are used to covering a patient with the snow, hoping for the return of spontaneous circulation. 1812, description by the Baron, there was a use of the therapeutic hypothermia to preserve injured limbs and for its numbing effect during amputation. In 1937, Temple described the cooled a patient 32 degrees centigrade for 24 hours to prevent cancer cells from further multiplications. Later on in 1953, by the Bigelow and McBurney, they had found that in their experimental study, there is a beneficial effect of therapeutic hypothermia for brain and heart during cardiac surgery. In the following year, 1955, Rosomov and Gilbert, they demonstrate direct effect between body temperature and intracranial pressure and brain volume. So this is a case series published in Anesthesia Analgesia in 1959. In that, they had find out usefulness of the doing hypothermia after the cardiac arrest. They had shown there is a good survival chances. After these few initial reports, there is a lot of application of therapeutic hypothermia in many conditions, including the brain and spinal cord surgeries. But the meanwhile, there is a reporting of higher incidence of the arrhythmias as well as chances of the getting infection. So, in next few years, very rapidly, there was essentially therapeutic hypothermia use was abandoned. But again, after the 1990s, again there is interest to develop using therapeutic hypothermia after the cardiac arrest. Bernard et al. From the Australia, they studied the use of hypothermia in 22 patients who had out of hospital cardiac arrest. And their study was published in 1997, Annals of Emergency Medicine. In these patients, they had a use 33 degrees centigrade, they maintained for the 12 hours. And they compared their results with the control group who had previously applying the therapeutic hypothermia. In the control group, there was 22 patients. In that, normothermia was applied. They had found out the outcome improves with the hypothermia. Both chances of the survival and as well as neurological recovery was almost 50%. Sorry. Next year, in 1998, one study from Japan by Yanagawa published in the Research Edition. They also studied the use of hypothermia in out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. So they applied 33 to 34 degrees centigrade for 48 hours in 13 patients. They also compared 15 patients with the normothermia in whom it was applied before the starting of protocol of therapeutic hypothermia. They also had found out improved chances of survival as well as neurological recovery after applying of the hypothermia. Sorry. The same author from the Australia, Bernard et al., he conducted randomized control trial in the following years that was published in New England Journal of Medicine in 2002. And in their randomized control trial, one arm they had used hypothermia with 33 degree centigrade temperature in out of hospital cardiac arrest patients. They continued for 12 hours, while in the another arm in whom 34 patients were recruited and them after cardiac arrest normothermia was maintained. In their result, they concluded the chances of survival with a good outcome was significant higher, that is almost 50% in comparison to the maintaining normothermia after the cardiac arrest. In the same year, in the same journal, New England Journal of Medicine, another multicentric study across the European country by the hypothermia after cardiac arrest study group. This was again randomized control trial, and this was a big study. In the hypothermia group, they included 136 patients, while in the control group, 137 patients. The maintained hypothermic patient group with 32 to 34 degrees centigrade for 24 hours, while in the control group, they maintained normothermia. And they followed these patients up to the 6 months after recovery from the cardiac arrest, and they had found out that survival rate was 60% and neurological recovery was 55% once we used the hypothermia. That was much better than the normothermia group. In next 5 years, the lot of the studies come in the literatures. This is a table depicting almost 14 studies in next 5 years. So some of them are the prospective, some are the retrospective, some are from the academic institutes, some are from the primary care centers. The cooling duration were different. Few used 12 hours, few used 24 hours like this, as well as there is a primary outcome measurement was also different. Few followed these patient up to the 28 days, few followed up to the 6 months, few followed up to the hospital discharge. So in their in this article, they analyze separately the studies who compared hypothermia with the historical controls. So they had found out the using the therapeutic hypothermia, chances of survival is 50 to 70%, while neurological recovery was found good in 40 to 60%. Another group of the studies in which the hypothermia was compared with the without historical control, there is a ongoing normothermia patient. Same time, they had found out the chances of survival was varied between 40 to 80% in different studies, while good neurological outcome was present in quite variable from 20 to 70%. So all these studies shown there is a definitive improvement chances of survival as well as the neurological recovery after using therapeutic hypothermia in patient who had recovered from the cardiac arrest. Therapeutic hypothermia, practical considerations. So the few definitions evolved in last few years, like hypothermia is defined as a core temperature below 36 degrees centigrade regardless of the cause, induced hypothermia, and intentional reduction of a patient's core temperature below 36 degrees centigrade. Therapeutic hypothermia is defined as a controlled induced hypothermia, that is induced hypothermia with potentially deleterious effects such as shivering being controlled or suppressed. While mild therapeutic hypothermia, that is a quite frequently used term in the literature, is now defined as an intentional and controlled reduction of a patient's core temperature to 34 degrees centigrade to 35.9 degrees centigrade. While moderate therapeutic hypothermia is defined as an intentional and controlled reduction of a patient's core temperature to 32 degrees centigrade to 33.9 degrees centigrade. So what are the current indications for using therapeutic hypothermia? So with the available evidence, we can say we have to use therapeutic hypothermia after successful resuscitation from a witness out of hospital cardiac arrest. You can also use therapeutic hypothermia after in hospital cardiac arrest. And who are the comatose? GCS is below than 8 after return of spontaneous circulation and before initiation of the cooling. As well as it is a great benefit if patient had an initial rhythm of ventricular fibrillation or non-perfusing ventricular tachycardia. Patient with other initial rhythm may also benefit. So most of the benefit you will get if patient had initially resuscitation from the witness out of hospital cardiac arrest who are still comatose, that is GCS less than 8, and if you find out that initial rhythm of the presence of ventricular fibrillation. So they had a great benefit by using therapeutic hypothermia. There are also few contraindications for using therapeutic hypothermia. Like if you receive the patient with core temperature below 30 degrees centigrade on admission. Second, patient who were comatose before the cardiac arrest, pregnant patient, patient who are terminally ill, patient with inherited blood coagulation disorder. These are the relative contraindication for using therapeutic hypothermia. What are the physiological aspects of using the cooling? There are different phases namely three phases. Like, first one is the induction phase, second maintenance phase, third rewarming phase. The aim of the induction phase is to get temperature below 34 degrees centigrade and then down to the target temperature as quickly as possible. While in maintenance phase, our aim is to tightly control with the minimum fluctuation, allowable range is 0.2 degree centigrade to 0.5 degree centigrade. While in rewarming phase, it should be slow and controlled warming. The target rate of rewarming phase is we have to increase temperature 0.2 degree centigrade to 0.5 degree centigrade per hour. This is a time course of three phases of hypothermia. In this, you can see, once you receive the patient either with the high temperature or normal temperature, then you have to start the induction phase. It should be very rapid. Induction phase should last between the 30 to 120 minutes. So you have to achieve induction phase within a 2 hours. There is a rapid cooling that may lead to a small overshoot, which should be accepted provided it is a no greater than 1 degree centigrade. The maintenance phase usually lasts 24 hours or minimal and as well as there should be minimal fluctuation in temperature during maintenance phase. The rewarming phase should be slow and controlled with rewarming rates of 0.2 degree centigrade to 0.5 degree centigrade per hour. Fever should be prevented after the rewarming. There are few specific issues that are related to particular phase during therapeutic hypothermia. Like during induction phase, there is a chances of the hypovolemia, electrolyte disorders, hyperglycemia. Dosing of sedation, insulin, vasoactive agents, fluid and electrolytes administrations, ventilator settings, you have to titrate during induction phase. There is also risk for the, if you rapid induce, then chances of these side effects can be reduced. So you have to achieve targeted temperature during the induction phase as early as possible to reduce the complications. While in the rewarming phase, there is a chances of hyperkalemia and hypoglycemia. The risk can be reduced by the slow warming. So we should remember, induction phase should be rapid, maintenance phase should be strictly controlled, very tightly controlled temperature, while rewarming phase should be slow. After the rewarming phase, we should not allow any temperature in the patient, because the presence of the temperature after the rewarming phase, it is independent predictor of worse outcome. So we should remember, maintenance of strict normothermia following the rewarming phase. What are the methods of the cooling? One, broadly you can say surface cooling. You can achieve surface cooling by either air or water circulating blankets and pads applied to the body. With this we can achieve 1 degree centigrade per hour to 1.5 degree centigrade per hour. While also you can use ice packs applied to the body. With this we can achieve with the rate of 0.9 degree centigrade per hour to 1 degree centigrade per hour. But it is a very cheap, easy, available. You can start using the ice packs out of the hospital, in fact, in the ambulance itself. Others are like multiple metal plates on the body and pre-cooled. They are at the temperature minus 20 degree centigrade. So they can reduce the temperature with the rate of 3.3 degree centigrade per hour. There is also availability of cap devices that call the helmets. You can achieve with these with the rapidity 0.5 degree centigrade per hour to 1.1 degree centigrade per hour reduction in the temperature. Another method you can categorize as a core cooling. There are different methods to achieve by the core cooling. One is the intravascular catheters. There are the intravascular balloons filled with the cold saline, and as well as there are also availability of the metal catheters. Another method for the core cooling is the infusion of the ice cold 4 degree centigrade fluids. You can keep in your ambulance, in your emergency room, and you can infuse the ice cold saline to achieve the target temperature. Another expensive method are the extracorporeal circulation. These are the very effective, rapid, but very expensive. So this is a one picture that shows the water circulating wrapping garments. You can see the body is wrapped with the some special garments in which the water circulate actually, and you maintain the temperature. So this is the surface cooling. Sorry. This picture taken from the New England Journal of Medicine published in 2010, this shows different methods to achieve the cooling of the patient. Like you can see, there is a surface cooling methods. One of them are the pre-cooled surface cooling pads or water circulating surface cooling pad. While in the another group, core cooling methods, you can use the ice cold salines, or there are cold saline as well as the catheters, different special catheter to achieve the core cooling. Monitoring of the temperature is a very essential part for applying the therapeutic hypothermia. Pulmonary artery catheter. If you use the temperature monitoring by this method, level of accuracy is very high, and you can say it is a gold standard. While others like the jugular bulb, esophageal, they have also have a very high level of accuracy, but they take time. You can also use the bladder and rectum site for the temperature monitoring, or also nasopharynx, tympanic membrane, or maybe forehead also. But always remember, never use peripheral site like axilla, groin for temperature monitoring during therapeutic hypothermia. They are completely inaccurate. What are the physiological changes and the side effect of the cooling? You should be well aware about these things also. Shivering is one of the important and very frequent side effects during applying therapeutic hypothermia. It increases in the metabolic rate and oxygen consumption. So we have to use to control the shivering. So there is a protocol. We can reduce the chances of the shivering by using the sedative, anesthetics, opiates, and or paralyzing drugs. We can also use the skin counter warming, that is by warming of the hands, feet, and face while you cool the patient. Drug protocol to reduce the incidence and the side effect of the shivering is, at the time of starting, give bolus of the fentanyl in adult patient 50 to 100 microgram and magnesium 30 millimole along with the continuous infusion of midazolam or propofol. If shivering persists, then repeat bolus of fentanyl and magnesium, and also you can increase sedative infusion rate. But if severing further persists, then consider clonidine, meperidine, or in the extreme cases, you can use the paralyzing agents also. What happened to the metabolism? As I already told you, like in the brain as well as in the other part of the body, with each reduction in degree centigrade of the temperature, there is overall reduction of metabolism by 6 to 7%. There is also reduction in oxygen consumption and production of the CO2 while we cool the patient.